Guys, Nana's quirk is float. And let's face it, it's called float, but it's pretty much flight. And I just want to say, I said flight for my predictions right before this chapter landed. You can even go see it. It's dated. You can go see the video. I'm pretty happy that I was able to get close enough to one. I'm going to call it a win. Flight, float, not the same thing, but by the time that Izuku gets it, it's going to be effectively flight. I'm pretty happy. I'm so happy. It only would have been better if he just called it flight. But hey, whatever, man. This is a great time. Great time. Anyway, I hope you enjoy the video. We're going to talk about a lot of stuff. Hey everybody, it's Tripl-L coming in to talk about My Hero Academia chapter 257 with all of you. It's going to be a fun one. This was another Calm Before the Storm type chapter. It feels like this arc has been just entirely Calm Before the Storm. But yeah, we're here. One thing I want to tell you guys about is like, hey, welcome. I think it's been a while, right, since we've made a Hero Academia chapter video. Hey, welcome. I hope you're having a great day. And to everyone that joins me on the live streams on Wednesdays and Thursdays, thanks for being here. This is going to be a fun one. Now, I want to tell you guys something I'm going to be doing with the Hero Academia chapters and ideally the other Shonen Jump chapters once I get the time to make them, is that before coming in to do the review, I will be reading like the 7 or 10 chapters before the current one. And the reason I'm doing this is because as I'm going through Hero Academia, I realize that the author is putting a lot of effort in really small places. There's a lot of callbacks in Hero Academia in general. And I feel like if I know what's just happened, if I read through, I can give you guys a better experience and hopefully minimize my own mistakes. Because sometimes when I'm reading these in the first go, there's some mistakes. So what that really means for you is that maybe you're going to get more cool details. I'm not too sure how it's going to shake out. I'm going to be trying this out, but I hope you find the videos informative or at the very least fun. And if I am ever wrong, I hope you feel comfortable enough to tell me that I am wrong. Anyway, let's get into it. This is Hero Academia chapter 257. Like I said, it is another Calm Before the Storm chapter. We're going to start the page by page walkthrough right now. And the first page is just a re-establishing and re-entry page, just pretty much picking up where we left off on the last chapter. So this is the first really important big thing going on here, is that All Might could not figure out or could not find any information on the second and third users. Not only that, he goes on to say that maybe they left something behind themselves. And when I'm reading that line, I'm thinking, yeah, they could have left something behind that could give Izuku a plot point to chase. Right now, there's a lot of mystery surrounding the second and third users because even Izuku doesn't know what they look like. So when I'm seeing this, it tells me that Horikoshi does want to set up a discovery plotline when it comes to identifying the second and third users. And also there is All Might saying that they might have left something behind, which to me really does sound like it's going to be a treasure hunt kite type of plot. Ooh, my words. Yeah, a treasure hunt type of plot for those two. Now, I want to quickly remind you guys because someone pointed this out to me on the live stream and I didn't realize and it was pretty epic. But here is the image of the second and third users. So this is the image from chapter 194. It shows us the users that we are aware of and it shows us the fourth, fifth, and sixth users along with Nana. We already know from this chapter, we know what numbers the other ones that we know of are in the placement. And then just the two are kind of in the background. This image doesn't give you much little details. This image doesn't really blow your mind. But because of the efforts of two commenters, Nicholas Rivera and Tala Wolf, who pointed it out to me, there is something kind of crazy going on with those silhouettes, and I will make a proper video for this later, but I want you guys just to see it here. This is the image from chapter 193, and apologies if you guys already know it. I know it's a popular theory, but you have this image of this guy who looks kind of like Bakugo when you look at what's on his gauntlet. It's kind of freaky. The other person kind of reminds... I'm seeing like there's a gear on his shoulder that kind of looks a little bit like Kirishima, but might not be Kirishima. Point is, right now, we're in a situation where there is something strange going on in the silhouettes, and it's kind of interesting. So when we come back to this one, and I see that All Might is saying that he couldn't find the second and third users, and there's a Bakugo in the picture, I do find that a little bit funny just because in my head right now, I'm thinking, could Bakugo actually be that silhouette? So it's kind of interesting that the thought bubble was in... the same panel as Bakugo, but that might just be confirmation bias. I just wanted to share that theory with you guys. I know that they told me to credit Turtle Quirk as the person that came up with it first or something. I don't really know, but it's a cool theory. I'm still thinking a little bit about it. Anyway, moving on to the next page. So page 2 is pretty much the page where we find out about Banjo and Black Whip and his user. Oh, sorry, and the user and, you know, his hero name, all that kind of stuff. Good stuff all around. What I really appreciated in this page was Izuku pointing out that he's not on the same level as Seiro and Aizawa. That's also pretty interesting, saying that Aizawa is on the same level as Seiro in terms of manipulating the Aizawa's scarf thing. What would we call it? Tape? Would we call it tape? I forget what to call it. Anyway, you know, Aizawa's gear. That was pretty interesting, just like that nice little nod. I never would have thought that Aizawa had that same level of maneuverability as Seiro does. Like, that didn't click in my head, but that makes a lot of sense. So I like that the author pointed that out, made that super clear. And it's cool that Izuku is putting Seiro and Aizawa as his goals. Because it's also funny, because in the previous chapter, Seiro had pointed out that Izuku was becoming too close, or he was becoming too similar to Seiro. So I really appreciate that. Another thing that I appreciate is that the author has maintained the rhetoric that Izuku can only maintain it for a second. I like that that's very consistent throughout the last 10 chapters. Pretty cool. And in that first little bit, we also find out that Izuku has not had any more contact with the One for All Shadows. Anyway, we get the panel of Lariat, or Banjo. And this panel is pretty interesting. When you look at what he's doing, first off, him using Black Whip looks pretty freaking cool. It looks like a cool image, like a guy running on the walls because he's holding on with Black Whip. Come on, it's cool. But what I'm really interested in is because this chapter was talking about how bad society was before, All for One went down. And when you look at Banjo's panel and you look in the background, everything is destroyed. This man is being shot in the building he's running on. But when you look below him, there is a building that is totally demolished. There's another couple of holes in at least two blocks. Actually, maybe three blocks of destruction. And this is aggressive destruction. We haven't seen that level of destruction. I'm actually kind of wondering how Japan rebuilt with all that collateral damage that was going on. Anyway, when you see Banjo there, it really makes you feel like this is a war zone. It really makes you feel like these people are just, this is not a great place to live. Like, holy crap moly. Which is actually really interesting because this chapter was talking more about what All for One did to society. It was kind of talking about how bad things were. And with where we are in the story and with where this chapter ends up, I do think it's kind of interesting that we're seeing these images now. But we'll talk about that at the end of the chapter. Anyway, we move on to page 3, and Bakugo pretty much tells us something that is unfortunate because it's pretty much the segue into we're not going to find out the quirks of the 4th and 6th users because Banjo was the 5th. I think that's the correct numbers. Because Bakugo starts off by saying that they don't have strong quirks. So already that kind of limits a lot of things, and that kind of should put a lot of people's fears at ease, which is pretty good. Of course, these quirks are all going to be powered up by One for All. So ideally, even though they are at base not amazing in their scope, they should still be a little bit of a game breaker when it comes for Izuku to fight off against other enemies. Anyway, you have that quick little discussion between Izuku and Bakugo where Izuku calls Bakugo too cruel because the quirks are just not that great and him calling them nobodies. And then we go into All Might's explanation as to why they may have ended up or why One for All may have gone to people with weaker quirks. Through All Might's description here of him describing how these guys were just laying down to die and how the past users were trying to make sure that the power would just go forward, it makes it kind of feel more like these guys were in a constant struggle for life and it was like a relay race. Like they are just trying their best. When they got wiped out, it's like, okay, there's no other choice. You gotta take this, man. You gotta take this and run with it. So I kind of like the sense of desperation that All Might is adding to the previous generations because it then comes to a culmination in the next page where All Might says they weren't really chosen ones. Through all of those battles, all they could do was receive the quirk and then entrust it to another. That really does make it feel desperate. And I really started to wonder how long did these characters actually hold One for All for? It's really interesting. Anyway, this idea that they weren't chosen ones is important. Like, I don't think he's saying chosen ones as in like, oh my god, you're the kid of destiny. No. He means chosen ones as in people that were legitimately picked by the original user or by the previous user, without the threat of death right over the top of their heads. Like people, when they had the time to actually go through the processing, oh, I would rather pick you. That's what I think All Might is implying when he says they aren't chosen ones. Because when you look at the succession here, all these people are on the deathbeds. Like, holy crap, that poor sixth user. I feel really bad for the sixth user. Like, he lost an arm, man. Like, these guys, what was going on? All for One must have been... Yeah, that's the name. Must have really been going for these guys. So I do like that whole panel of showing their deaths. I do hope that Izuku eventually accesses those memories so he could see how bad this got for them. But I do like how the fourth one gave it off to Banjo. I like how Banjo passed it on to Six. And I like how Six passed it on to Seventh. And you can tell it's Nana receiving it because you can see Nana's glove in that little panel there. So I love that the author showed this because this made this feel a lot more real. What the author wants to paint with this previous generation is that these were the guys that were messing around when All for One was at the peak of his power. And they were clearly on a losing battle here. These guys are just passing the power along, hoping that one day it's going to get strong enough to deal with All for One. And it really does make them feel more like they were part of a team here. A team that kind of transcends generations. But yeah, man, seeing a number six there crying, and that kind of sucked. But I really wish that the author would have just told us about the other two instead of just telling us that Izuku and Bakugo know about them. That's like my only real sad point about the chapter. I wanted more information. Anyway, Izuku goes on to point out, and I'm kind of sad that we can't see what the book is saying. I really wish we could see what the book was saying, but I wish it was translated. I got so much value out of knowing what Ray's letter said. I kind of wish the book was translated. Anyway, Izuku says they all died young, and that makes sense. If All for One is actually going out there and trying to kill all of them, it makes sense that they died young, because they pretty much all put a giant target on their back, and given that they're all dying... like on their deathbeds when they just got mauled by some kind of villain, it probably meant like All for One knew how to keep tabs on these guys. Now hopefully this wasn't just when we see these three passing the power on to each other, hopefully this wasn't all in the span of days, right? Hopefully there was like some years in between these guys passing the power along, but we don't really know. And with how dogged of a pursuit All for One is depicted as having in this chapter, yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know. Anyway, the page 4 segues us into what quirk is Izuku going to get next. And the one that All Might reveals is Nana's quirk Float. As you saw at the beginning of the video, I'm pretty excited because I put in as one of my predictions a flight ability. Something that was pretty much going to make Izuku Superman. And I see Nana floating here. Not only am I taken away by how muscular she is, I also think it's a really elegant quirk. It's called Float, but I'm sure there's a nice degree of control that Nana has with it. Anyway, it was also really cool to see this image of Gran Torino and Nana together. They are thematically linked, and that's pretty cool to see. We move on to page 6, and page 6 is, well, Bakugo showing off page, pretty much. It's a characterization page. It's a character interaction page. One of the points that I think is really interesting coming out of this is that Izuku's getting something that someone else already has. So this is something that has already popped up with Zero. Zero already has the functionality of Black Whip. And here you have a situation where Izuku is gaining flight and Bakugo has already kind of replicated the flight ability with his explosion power. Now one of the big takeaways that you look there is that Bakugo really does legitimately just have a very, very versatile quirk. You go back to what Bakugo said to Endeavor, and it's like his quirk legitimately can do a lot. And this is just that reminder, Bakugo's quirk can do a lot. And it's more like the character is just so competent that he makes his quirk do a lot, which is really good to see. Anyway, we move into page 7, and that's the transitionary page of just All Might appreciating the relationship between Izuku and Bakugo. And it is kind of cool to know that Izuku sees this as a progression in their relationship, that they're talking with each other, even if it is just Bakugo being insanely competitive. Seeing All Might smile there was really nice, and it does kind of lead into later when he's having that heart-to-heart with Aizawa. Anyway, we transition over into the kids doing stuff, and we have that reference to the boys being under house arrest, and we're back with Class 1A. Now, these pages are super fun, and they are definitely the pages of This is the Calm Before the Storm. Honestly, it reminds me a lot of the Christmas chapter, just because of the camaraderie between the kids and all of them coming together and hanging out. It was really feel-good, and I think the author is trying to pump up those feel-good moments because he wants to make whatever disaster, he needs to make that contrast really stick. Now, page 8 has a lot of wonderful little details. In that first panel, I absolutely love that Izuku immediately ran off to help while Bakugo didn't. That reminds me of how Izuku is the kind of person, as Todoroki explained, he's going to be sorry if he doesn't help. So that was cool to see that characterization there and Izuku running off. Another thing that was also really nice is that we got the return of Horikoshi's happy faces. We had two of it in this page. We had one in that first panel with Ochako and Momo, and then second time Horikoshi made sure that we know that the happy face is right there. So that was really cute. He does this pretty often, and it's cute to see the happy faces. Another great little moment is when Bakugo criticizes Shoto for not having his sister's skills. We know that Bakugo sees Shoto's sister Fuyumi with a lot of respect, given that he took one of her recipes, or he asked for one of her recipes, so he clearly respects her as a chef. So this was a funny little callback to that whole relationship with Fuyumi. Really enjoyed that. The other thing that was really nice in this page is that we know that Class 1B is coming by later, and Kodai is bringing an extra sofa. Kodai is the girl that has the size quirk. She can reduce the size of inanimate objects, I believe. So it makes sense that she's bringing the extra sofa. So that was actually really neat. And I like the reference or the call over to Class 1B. Now we go into page 9. And page 9 sets up the reasoning for why we are actually doing a hot pot. It's because these kids are going into the new term. They're going to be there from January to March. They're going to be doing all their good stuff. And then they are doing a work-study brainstorm. So I guess they're talking about like how much more to improve on their work studies. They're probably coming up with new ideas for their work study. So that's pretty cool. We have another big shot of all the characters. And there's a lot of... Well, I think there were a few neat little details. First off, I love that Mina was about to fall off and Tsuyu was the one to catch her. I didn't do the count and all the characters are there for Class 1A. Other little things that were really neat for this one, Izuku's sitting next to Aoyama, which makes sense. They are friends, so it's cool to see them always together. And then we have Koda. He has his bunny out with him. So that was cool to see. It's really neat seeing all the characters together again. Anyway, we continue the interactions into page 10. The first panel of page 10 I thought was a little bit interesting just because I don't fully understand what's going on in that first panel. I don't know if Toru is using her quirk because Toru is laughing. She's mentioning that something hasn't been heated up yet. And then Ojiro says that she's doing something on purpose. I don't know how the author wants to show off Toru's power because you can see that some people are obscured. Bakugo. So I don't know if that's the steam of the hot pot or if Toru is just using light bending. Hard to tell, but it's just a nice little panel and it's nice to see Ojiro and Toru still having their little communications in chapters. Now there is something that gets me a little bit concerned in this page of the kids just having fun. You know, after the girls have their lines, we have the middle page. The second middle panel where it says we get to greet new first years, but since the hero course doesn't have clubs, we won't interact with them much. A whole new crop of hero hopefuls. I love it. That little bit is actually really concerning when we know the timeline here. The school year starts in April from what I believe. I think I looked at that correctly. It ends in March and starts up in April. That's actually really concerning because when I'm looking at that, I'm wondering, are you setting up this potential that we won't reach? Is UA actually going to get a bunch of new years? A bunch of first years in the next year coming up? Is something going to happen that's going to make people fear UA? Is something going to happen that's going to make people not want to send their kids to UA? Are we going to have a reduced amount? Setting up the expectation of greeting new years is really concerning with where we are. But we'll talk more about that at the end of the chapter. Anyway, a big thing happened in the bottom place where someone is specifically saying we still have 3 months remaining. When you look at where we ended up in the chapter, the author saying that we have 3 months remaining honestly sounds to me like the author wanted us to know how much time we're actually going to be passing up here when we go to the end of the chapter. So that's 3 months of progress for these kids. This takes me back to what Bakugo had mentioned in one of the previous pages. specifically back when he was talking to Izuku about how amazing he is, he says he'll be polishing their moves at the work study. So this is important, right? Because we have to remember that there is that commission plot that's in the background that wants to set up the kids as reserves for whatever disaster might be coming. Remember, the kids are reserves in a war, or that's how the commission is viewing it. So the big thing here with Bakugo reminding you of the work study, and then you getting the reminder of the three months left, and then knowing that Endeavor already worked out a schedule for the kids to keep coming to the work study in spite of their schooling, that tells you that in those 3 months, these kids are all still growing. They're all still in a very strong growth phase. It tells you that, like, however far these guys were able to go with Endeavor in just of such a quick time, they're going to be able to go further now with 3 months. So that was a really good thing on the author. It's a really cool thing that he did, because he's reminding you of the relevant plot elements. He reminded you that the work study is still in play, and he reminded you that there's 3 months left to go here. Anyway, we go into page 11, I believe, and we have Izuku reflecting on life. He's reflecting that he's actually here at UA. He never imagined that All Might would be there. He never imagined that he could have a kind of normal conversation with Bakugo. So this is one of those reflection moments to really, really cement that we are in a very nice calm before the storm. We are in a very nice, peaceful time. Anyway, you have that wonderful page of appreciation where Izuku realizes that he is very blessed. And then you have the comedy moment of Tokoyami asking for the ponzu. So that was really neat, and from there we transition into All Might and Aizawa. Now the All Might and Aizawa moment is really special, because All Might and Aizawa, they're a little bit opposed. Like they have differences, they have some different opinions. We know that they are contrasting figures. We know their relationship from the first era, that these guys are just too different. But this was a very nice moment between the two. In their first page, what's really valuable, aside from the fact that they're talking, is that Eri is going to be trained next week. Now, all throughout Hero Academia, I did a reread because I was looking for information for Eri videos. Eri right now is kind of serving like a countdown. She is now a bomb that is primed with that horn. So it's going to be interesting to see what the author wants to do. He's been consistently reminding us of Eri's presence throughout all the arcs leading up to this point. So this is just, to me, it looks like it's a buildup for something about to go off. So anyway, it's cool that All Might and Aizawa are going to be training Eri. Where will she be by the end of 3 months? I don't know. Anyway, we go into page 14, a really wonderful page of All Might pointing out that he wants to do more, that he wants to keep on living. This is just adding more to the All Might rhetoric, to the All Might's gonna die rhetoric. The chapter even reminds you of Night Eye. Really interesting. It's also really interesting that we got that Night Eye episode yesterday, and we have All Might referencing it here. I do think the author is kind of referencing the events of the anime a little bit, just for fun, just because they're happening at the same time. But regardless, it was a really good talk between Aizawa and All Might, especially Aizawa calling out All Might for being a workaholic and putting it in perspective that this guy has been working in the country for decades. You know, it's okay to have that kind of like crisis where you don't know what you want to do. We go though into page 15. Page 15 is important because Aizawa's going in and he's saying you can live, you can be here. For a lot of people, that's the push that they need. Now, what I want to emphasize is that Aizawa is saying, like, you can stay specifically in UA. This is the second chapter in a row where Aizawa has put importance to the idea of UA. In 256, he was talking to Eri and he was pretty much telling Eri that it's going to be fine. This is UA. Here he's talking to All Might. He's saying you can stay here in UA. UA stands as a symbol of peace, or stands as a symbol of safety. So when you consider that, and we're going into the next little bit where Izuku is saying that this is the day that heroes disappeared from the city, I do think Aizawa inadvertently ends up establishing UA as a point of As a point that if you took it down, you'd be taking down a whole symbol. We'll talk more about that at the end of the chapter. It all comes together. Anyway, we go into the final pages, page 16. There's a lot of beautiful things going on here. First, you know, All Might's appreciation. But then we go into actually the really important information that Tsukachi said he wants All Might to delay seeing Stain. This is important. This is the reminder. This is the author reminding the readers Stain is a factor. How can Stain be a factor? Well, when you consider that Stain is being brought up here and there is a delay to see him, I don't think that means that Tsukachi is saying that All Might wait 3 months to see Stain. I think more that's just a message to tell All Might, like, hey, you know, or to tell us inadvertently, hey, Stain, a factor. One thing I want to say before we go into the final bit of theory making is that we get a... Well, the author reminds us of the visual metaphor. He shows us the trees blooming. Now, if you go back to chapter 246, I believe, we had that whole little bit with Fuyumi praying. We had that whole montage. We had that line, let's hope that the next time the cherry blossoms fall, we will all be small. We will all be smiling. And then we had this panel of the barren tree. So this is just, I think, a visual metaphor that has been has continued along. I do hope that by the time the cherry blossoms fall, everything will be cool. But I do love that the author followed up with that. I do love that the author showed off that progression. I do like that he thematically linked chapter 257 to 246 through the imagery of the cherry blossoms. Will we actually get to a point that by the month that passes by, like a month after March, will we get to a point where everyone's smiling again? Honestly, don't know. We go into the final page that tells us we are at the end of the March. We just skipped the 3 months that Ida set us up for. And we have someone saying that, good morning, doctor, you're a rare sight. And then you have Izuku ending off the narration that day, heroes vanished from the city. First off, with the doctor being told that he's a rare sight, that's pretty much the narrative telling us the doctor hasn't been seen around very often. He is now being seen. The doctor is most likely done with whatever big thing he was doing. That's terrifying because that pretty much means Shigaraki is close enough to being active. And then the final little bit that day, heroes vanish from the city. I want to be very careful with this. You guys know how I feel about Hero Academia in general when they're hyping things up. I take it with a grain of salt. I do want to like just remind you, this is a very sensational ending. The day the heroes vanish from the city, not Japan. So this is a very localized attack. If it's a localized attack, that makes things kind of scary, because if this is Izuku saying it, it kind of makes me feel that maybe he's referring to the city closest to UA or something like that. Regardless, it's localized. There is something that happened that made all the heroes disappear. That's kind of intense. I do wonder if this is sensational. I do wonder if this is just Izuku telling us this is the day that all the heroes came together to fight a giant army. That's why they vanished from the city. Okay, hey everyone. You might notice I look a little bit different. It's because I'm re-recording. Because I didn't dive into the point about counter-ops at all. Which was kind of weird. But let's just talk about that part. And then I'll tell you when we're going back into the video proper. Anyway, with where I just left off, I just mentioned counter-ops. I want to just kind of elaborate on that point. Because I think this is probably the most likely. I have another theory behind that. Just talking about in terms of long term. But yeah, in terms of the heroes probably doing counter ops in conjunction with this whole thing about, this was the day that heroes disappeared. Here's how I'm thinking about it. Given that Hawk said he would send Endeavor a signal, given that the 4 month wait period was given in January, that means, you know, February, March, April, you know, kind of like that. Given that we still have time here, given that it's only been 3 months, given that it's an army of 10,000, it's likely that the heroes were pulled away for the commission's operation. The chances that the villains make the first strike, I don't think it's zero. Like there was, I think, back in chapter 245, Spinner was being asked if everything is just as they discussed. So it makes you feel like the villains have plans on the down low. But anyway, given the information that we have from Hawks, and if we want to assume competency on the part of Hawks, eventually the Hero Commission would have to attack. And if we're talking about a counter op from the heroes, given that there's 10,000 in the numbers, I would totally believe that the commission would pull heroes out and have them gathered specifically to take out 10,000 people. Do you need that many heroes to actually deal? Like, do you need a city's worth of heroes to go and deal with 10,000 of the Liberation Army? Honestly, questionable, because five villains were able to demolish them pretty easily. I really feel like you only need like top quality heroes that can deal with crowd control. Numbers in Hero Academia are always like a messy place. I think giving the heroes more might be a little bit too much. But yeah, in terms of like the most likely scenario that I'm seeing when I see the heroes vanish from the city, I'm assuming it's the heroes went in an operation to take down the other guys, and then that didn't work well for them. Who knows? I don't think that actually every hero was pulled for this operation. Like, that's just irresponsible. Probably there are more heroes left here. But if you were to ask me, I would say like maybe this is the start of the commission's plot. Now, if we were to go to more extreme theories, we would say like, okay, maybe this is the day that the villains attacked. They did some kind of weird shenanigan. Who knows? Possible, but it's kind of too much. But at that point, we can talk about the elements that this chapter brought up. You know, Stain and Aizawa's reinforcement of UA. You know, when I'm seeing Stain there, you know, the only reason you would bring up Stain is if he's going to be involved in whatever's going on at the prison. And so, you know, I see this first thing about the heroes vanishing, and I'm just thinking, okay, you know, could this lead into a prison break? Could this lead into Shigaraki going into the prison, or the villains going into the prison to extract their valuables before Shigaraki destroys everything? Maybe. Given that UA is, or the hero schools are, this trove of amazing quirks, is it possible that the villains could go to UA before Shigaraki destroys everything, or like during, to go and take stuff out? There's a lot of potential here. But if I was to say like my own little ideas here, it's probably we are going into a hero operation, because then that gives Ox Buildup some credit. And then from there, we are moving into maybe a UA attack, or maybe we are moving into a prison break. Maybe we're doing both at the same time. Who knows? It's like, there's a lot of really cool potential here. But yeah, like that day, the heroes vanished from the city. Like, it could be quite literally anything. It's quite a wide sentiment. And it's going to be interesting to see which path the author wants to take. Is he going to make the heroes be effective and go in before Shigaraki is completed in his 4 months? Or are the heroes going to get blindsided? We'll have to see. The thing is, because there are a 3-month time skip, the heroes could legitimately have figured out a lot of stuff that we just wouldn't know. But yeah, that's the theory portion. I will return you to the guy that was talking from yesterday. And I think you might only repeat a few things that I just said. Anyway, thanks. When you look at that final image of UA, it really depends on what the author wants to do. Does he want to make UA a place that has to survive a siege? Or does he want to make UA a place that stands as a beacon in the darkness? And we had to talk about the events post this. Post the attack on UA, if it were to happen, or post the attack on the prison, or post the vanishing of the people from the city, are we going to go back into total anarchy like the All for One days? That would be absolutely terrifying. That clip of Banjo was the reminder that this was a terrible time period. Do we actually want to go back into that time period? Are people going to bring themselves back into that time period themselves? Are they going to let themselves go back into anarchy? Yeah, you hope that that doesn't happen. Or are the events at UA going to be so traumatic that it prevents people, or it makes parents not want to send their kids to UA? A lot of things are being brought up. Class 1B is being brought up. I feel like if there is ever an attack on UA, the sacrificial pawns are pretty much Class 1B. They've been set up for that. Well, not really. They've been built up so that you can have something to take away from the story, I feel. But yeah, no. We are now standing at a point of full potential. We'll have to see how the villains want to attack. I'm not very clear on the time frame of Shigaraki's surgeries, but you know, we're close enough that Shigaraki could mount a preemptive strike while he is still recovering, if he isn't fully recovered. It is a very scary time. There's a lot of pieces being brought up. But one thing that we do know for sure, and this is something we can take solace in, is that Mirio will be a wonderful hero one day. That future probably isn't going to get changed. We know Izuku is going to be the number one hero in the future, or he's going to be the greatest hero in the future. So, you know, there is still those beams of hope. We still have so many storylines that need to be explored. We know that eventually Hawks and Bakugo are going to have to come for a confrontation about what went down with Best Genus, have some resolution. So there's still a lot of things that have to be covered. It's just an issue of how many things got covered in the 3-month time skip. We'll have to see. I'm very excited for January 26th because I do want to see just how crazy or how insane this is all going to get. And I do want to see how this whole that day heroes vanish from the city. I want to see how that unravels. Right now, when I look at that, it really makes me feel like the commission brought together a lot of heroes and put them out they got them together to go fight the Liberation Army or something like that. And then it just became a sensational headline. I'm sure actually there's probably like a few heroes still in the city. Like honestly, like this seems like the majority of the heroes left, but there's probably actually a few heroes in the city. There's probably still going to be heroes at UA, definitely. So it's not like everyone just totally abandoned the kids. But it's going to be interesting to see a situation where the kids have to come in as reserves. That's going to be interesting. Let's hope we don't go post-apocalyptic. I really hope that Hero Society never returns to what it was in Banjo's days. Anyway, everyone, let me know what you thought down below. Let me know what you're thinking about where we could go here. Let me know how you're interpreting the heroes vanish from the city. And let's call it there. Thank you very much for watching. Until next time, I hope you have a great day. And keep an eye out for any little videos that I might produce. I'm going to put up a differences comparison for not this week's episode, last week's episode. And putting up a preview video for the next episode of the Hero Academia anime, mostly because I need to help my channel's metrics. But keep an eye out. We've been doing fun stuff on the live streams, and that stuff will get onto the video, onto the channel as highlights. Anyway, yes, thank you very much for watching. Until next time, I hope you have an absolutely great day.